Okay, so it may not be the most elaborate way of doing it, but I just figured if I actually had a white background, I could show off the vinyl colors in a little bit more detail. And weirdly enough, everything on this episode, I've got a couple of vinyl records, but mostly everything is black vinyl. But hey, look, if I make the change now, future episodes will look glorious. And speaking of glorious, the album you see in front of you now is the amazing Let There Be Rock by AC/DC. And for some odd reason, I don't know why, but I will hold my hands up to it and say, this is the very first AC/DC album I have ever owned on vinyl. And I picked this up recently. In fact, the town I live in, there is a secondhand record store, maybe like a 10 minute walk from my house. It's really, really close by. I've picked up a bunch of stuff there that I've showed off on previous episodes. And I was in there maybe a week or so ago, and there were a few AC/DC albums. And yeah, okay, I'm familiar with Back in Black, Thunderstruck, Highway to Hell. You know, these are albums that I've owned on CD before and still do, actually. But I've never really done the deep dive into AC/DC's back catalogue, which is kind of a shame because I do like every song I've ever heard from them. So while I was there, I thought, you know what, this is crazy that I don't own any AC/DC. I'm going to go in there and I'm going to, you know, kind of grab a couple of these records. But the only one I actually left with that day was this really nice French pressing of Let There Be Rock. And as far as looks go, you know, kind of what's the difference, there isn't a hell of a lot of difference. The cover is just, you know, the cover of Let There Be Rock. It's got this great kind of band photo there. And the back of the record is pretty much where you see the only differences. As far as I can tell from my research, down here it says 70 Avenue de Champs-Élysées, 75008 Paris. So that's how I know it's a French version, and there's also some French writing on the album as well. It's not a fantastically rare pressing or anything like that. I think I paid maybe £20, something like that, and that's kind of what it goes for online in this condition as well. So I didn't grab myself a bargain. I grabbed myself an album that sold for the price that it usually sells for. And you know, I'm really happy with that. This killer picture on the back, I absolutely love this. Just one picture, not a band picture, just there you go. It's just, it is that cool. And the record itself, I did change the sleeve on it because, you know, after a while, those paper sleeves, they do have a tendency to kind of deteriorate in a way where you may find them sticking to the vinyl. It doesn't happen all the time, but it can happen. And for a lot of older records these days, or for a lot of secondhand records I buy, I do tend to replace the sleeves with these nice rice paper sleeves. These are kind of like the standard I think they use over in Japan. And there's a tons of places that have started using them over here as well. This is basically like a polyline sleeve with a sheet of rice paper inside. That's what that is. But it's got the beautiful, beautiful, bright and colorful Atlantic logo there. Let There Be Rock. Yeah, boy, Let There Be Rock indeed. And as you can see, or maybe you'll be able to see this, I'm not entirely sure if you'll be able to tell there, but there is French text around the outside, and it does actually say Made in France. And this is a fantastic album. You know, Let There Be Rock is obviously a killer song. And then the classic Whole Lotta Rosie, which, I mean, I think every rock fan on earth knows Whole Lotta Rosie. And from the tracks that I didn't know, I will say that I was pleasantly surprised with how much I really enjoyed this album. You know, I brought it home, cleaned it up, gave it a good clean. Usually with secondhand stuff, I'll give it maybe one or two cleans before it hits the turntable, depending on how it looks. I mean, this one did look pretty great, but I decided to just give it, you know, kind of like that extra deep clean, that extra loving touch. And it sounds great. Whole Lotta Rosie just sounds fantastic. It almost sounds like the band are playing kind of in the record room with me. It's so, so incredibly good. So if, like me, you've found yourself bereft of some AC/DC, I can heartily recommend picking up Let There Be Rock. Now, my next pick here, this may be looking kind of tiny, and well, That's because it's a cassette, as you may be able to tell. And this is documenting sound number 15, Concrete Feather by Dean Hurley. Now, for those of you that don't know who Dean Hurley is, Dean Hurley has worked with David Lynch now for, I think, like the past 15 or 18 years, something along those lines. And Dean Hurley did a lot of the ambient noise and sound design on Twin Peaks The Return. And that was released as a digital only album through Sacred Bones. I think it was probably like 2 years ago now. And that was part of his Anthology of Resource series, I believe is what it's called. There is a second one of those. I've spoken about it on a previous LP, but I really like the soundscapey noise kind of material. Not noise as in, you know, harsh noise, as in I just like ambient tones. I'm a really, really big fan of ambient tones. It's perfect reading listening material, so like listening material for when you're reading. I like it to kind of listen to when I'm going to bed at night. I'm not necessarily one of those people that's into ASMR, and I don't tend to listen to music all that much when I'm falling asleep. I prefer to listen to kind of tones and sounds, and Concrete Feather is absolutely perfect for that. I saw this advertised, I want to say I saw it advertised like last week, on Boomcat, which I believe is the only place where you can get this from. I think Documenting Sound is their own kind of brand. And what's cool about this is it's actually textured on the front here. And this is actually, I wondered how they did it. I was kind of like, wow, how did they do that? And then I figured it out, it's a sticker on the front. Really simple. It's just a white case with a sticker on, but it works really, really well. And the music on here, it's ambient tones, it's noise, it's fantastic, it's so, so good. And the whole white theme is carried out throughout the cassette. It's just a white cassette. There's no side A, no side B. You can listen to it in any order you so choose. And you do get a digital download as well with this when you purchase from Boomcat. I'll just put that off to one side. You do get this really nice J-card insert though, which I'm assuming this is kind of material that was used in the creation of the cassette. I haven't actually read these notes yet, so I will do that. This is really hard to move, but there we go. We're getting that quite nicely there. It's a nice little popper, and it's printed on the other side as well. And if you look very closely, there's a picture of a young Laura Palmer in there as well. So it definitely fits in with that whole Twin Peaks thing. If you're a fan of the ambient sounds and the ambient tones that are used in Twin Peaks, then this is definitely going to be up your alley. I would highly recommend this for anybody. If you're into ambient sounds, if you've picked up any of Dean Hurley's previous material, or if you're a fan of like guys like Graham Resnick, who did the sound design for a lot of Ty West films, this is going to be something you are definitely going to want to check out. I think it is a limited edition. I think it's maybe 100 copies, maybe 150, and it's available on Boomcat, which is B-O-O-M-K-A-T. So definitely go and check this one out. I would recommend it to anyone out there that's a soundtrack fan, or if you just like something a little bit different, some nice ambience, something to just kind of take the edge off, Concrete Feather would definitely be a recommendation. Now, unintentionally or intentionally, everything else I pretty much have for you today is film music related or soundtrack related. And as you can see, the album before you is the classic Star Wars, but this version, for those of you out there that don't know, this is a Japanese pressing of the Star Wars score, the Star Wars soundtrack by John Williams. And I recently picked up, eight Japanese soundtracks or eight Japanese scores from a good friend of mine that I'll be posting up on our social medias, but I'll also be kind of filling them in over the next few preceding episodes. I didn't want to do just a whole soundtrack episode on Japanese soundtracks. Although, if you guys are interested in that kind of thing and would like to see an episode of Japanese soundtracks, why don't you reach out to me on our social media at Record Room Show. You can find me on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. But what's different about this version? Well, the content is just Star Wars. There is no difference in the content. But as you can see from the front cover, it has this really, really gorgeous Obi strip, which has this really killer logo. And there's also a picture up the top there of the scene where they are traveling in the Millennium Falcon. You've got Chewie, Luke, Obi-Wan, and Han Solo there. And then the album itself is the Star Wars album. But on the inside, what's pretty cool is you get this back kind of advertisement for Star Wars. And I'm not 100% sure. Obi strips, the purpose of them was to explain what was in the album. So if there were free gifts, if there were any bonus material, you would read it on the Obi. And this edition, this version of Star Wars does come with a poster. But it's not that poster, but I am wondering, because I can't speak Japanese, if this is telling you that there is a poster inside. I don't know if that's what it's saying on the front or if it's on the back, but there you can see there's images from the film on both versions. I will show you one of the discs because it's pretty interesting. There's no actual Japanese kanji on there. In fact, it does say 20th Century Fox, Sunset Boulevard, but just above that it says manufactured and distributed by King Records Tokyo, and King Records did a ton of film music material. And you know, this album came out in 77, and you know, the Japanese, they were getting these really nice poly sleeves back then, whereas we're only kind of really starting to get them now, and not all the time, sadly. Inside the album, you do get this really nice 8-page insert. And what this does is it details the tracks on the album, and the album credits are actually all inside. And there's also a nice little thing here, a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. So there's a little typo there, which I think is pretty fun. It gives you a little bit of information about the film there, about the information on each track. And then on the back there, you have some information about the film and about the score. Recorded on March 5th to 16th, 1977, remixed at the Burbank Studios, Burbank, California, featuring liner notes by Charles Lippincott. So that is pretty fun information. And as I mentioned earlier, it does come with a poster. And I am a Star Wars fan. I have been my entire life. I was born in 78, so I didn't actually see any of the original Star Wars films in the movie theater. I'm just a little bit too young. But I've grown up with Star Wars my entire life, collecting the figures when I was a kid, rewatching the films. I've seen the films countless times. I own plenty still now of, you know, action figures and Star Wars ephemera. In fact, I'm wearing a Star Wars t-shirt today. I have Star Wars pajamas, slippers, everything. I'm a big Star Wars nut. And this poster, I'm not sure I've ever seen this before. And that it could just be that I haven't seen this image, but it's very cool. I'm going to try and show you all of it. I'll have to do it in sections because the camera doesn't fold out. Oh, sorry, the camera doesn't zoom out that far. But let me lay this out on the table and then I'll show it to you in sections, because it's actually a landscape poster. No, it's a vertical poster, but I have it in landscape form. And you can see this is just really cool. I'm sure this is just, you know, a promotional poster for the film. It may have been used for something else at some point, but it's just this really, really, really cool artwork. It's so neat. And that's kind of, if I can, I'm gonna bring this up so you can see a little bit more of it. Try and get rid of the light there. We can see the Falcon right in the middle there of the shot. So cool. And then the huge Death Star. And again, I didn't know that this poster came with it. I be honest with you, I own the Star Wars soundtracks. I have done many times over the years, and most of the ones I have now are the kind of recent reissues. There were some on gold vinyl. Those are the ones that I own, but I actually do have, I have Star Wars and I have Return of the Jedi, so I need to pick up Empire, which I probably will do. After seeing the other two, I can't not have Empire now, so I'm on the lookout for that. But this is just, it's a fantastic set. I'm really pleased I'm managed to add this to my collection. There are a few different versions of the Star Wars score that were released in Japan. So if you are on the lookout for it, I'd say try and track this one down, because I say you do get that lovely poster and the Obi is pretty badass. As I said, the second half of this show was going to be all soundtrack related, but I didn't say it was all going to be film soundtracks. And what you can see right here, right now, this is the fantastic score for Alien Storm, released by the classic company Sega, who did obviously Mega Drive, Master System, Game Gear, or Genesis if you're in America. There was the Sega Saturn, Sega Dreamcast. Sega are my favorite game company, if you will. I grew up with a Sega Mega Drive, then I had a Sega Game Gear, then a Sega Saturn, and I still actually to this day have I don't have a set, I'm just going to divert very quickly here, but I have an analog Mega SG set up in my living room so I can actually still play my Sega games in glorious HDMI, which is very, very cool. Anyway, the record you see before you is Alien Storm, the 20th release from the good folk at Datadiscs. And the score is super fun. It's very high energy synth. And I'm going to try and show this if you can. In fact, let me take this Obi off, because this Obi does actually detail what's inside the LP, which is very, very cool. But what I want to show you on this is the actual cover itself, because the cover is embossed. As you can see there, you actually get the tentacles on the sleeve are embossed. So it's a 3D effect just on the cover alone. And this is the, you know, this is the greatness of Datadiscs and why they really are one of the best record labels around right now releasing video game material. You can see the shine there. It's absolutely, absolutely beautiful, and featuring some of the original key art as well. Just huge, huge fan of this. And I'm going to read you the back of the sleeve, just in case you're unfamiliar with Datadiscs and what they do. So Alien Storm, music by Kasuke Tsukahara. Shape-changing alien scum take over your city. Fry the slimy horrors and smash their bid for global conquest. Blast into action with ray guns, flamethrowers, power whips, and more. Fight from two different perspectives, including a 3D view into the screen. The excitement is red hot in this arcade classic. Now, if that hasn't sold you, you just need to take a quick listen to the music and you will be fully on board with Alien Storm. And the score itself plays at 45 RPM. The only downside to this, I would say, is I wish there were more of it. I genuinely, genuinely wish there were more of it, because it's so cool. This version here is probably what you would class as the retail version. Datadiscs do a tremendous variance on which you can buy through their websites, which are limited to the websites. There will usually be some kind of splatter or different pattern, and then there'll be a quote-unquote retail version, which tends to be a single color. And that's the version I have here. But you do get this really sweet litho print of that cover. So if you like the album and you know you're a big fan of this, grab this, put it in a frame, put it somewhere nice. I have most of the Datadiscs releases, and at various points when I used to have kind of the shots of me in the record room, I'd always have an album behind me, and plenty of times Datadiscs albums have featured in that spot. And so what I'm going to show you now is actually one of the reasons why I switched from a black background to a white one, is so I could show off the colors on records like this, although this one is so green, it almost looks black. But yeah, this one is on a very cool kind of like alien slime green. I don't know if that's what you would class this as, but it's very cool. And sadly, you're not getting the effect that I'm getting, which is pretty cool. There's almost a faint hint of marbling in there as well. So there you go. That's Alien Storm by Datadiscs, available now. Now, I may just have to blow your minds ever so slightly, because what you can see before you is not a record. That's right, my friends. But this is something that I know will appeal to a bunch of you out there. And I actually saw this. Someone posted this on my Instagram feed, and I was tremendously grateful for it. This is the magazine Vinyl, issued by the Jazz City store in Japan. And this magazine is basically dedicated to Japanese vinyl bars. So for those of you that are unfamiliar, there are some bars in Japan. I don't think there are tons of them, but there are a few of them. Essentially, you go there and they play records. They have these huge record collections and these great sound systems, and they actually spin vinyl records while you're sitting there enjoying your drink. And this is part of Japanese vinyl culture. It's been there for a long, long time. And this is just a beautiful, beautiful magazine. And I probably would have bought this if it was just in Japanese. Even though I wouldn't have been able to read it, I would have been able to enjoy the wonderful pictures. However, this magazine is actually in English and Japanese. So you get Japanese first, and then you get the English text after. And there are five different bars, five different vinyl bars featured here. Sorry, I'm losing my train of thought, because it's just, I just look at these pictures and I'm just blown away. Like, the magazine we had over here in the UK, Long Live Vinyl, that's actually ceased being a magazine now. I think it's partially due to COVID. It could be that the magazine itself just, you know, the numbers weren't selling. I don't actually know, but it's a shame, because I was a big fan of that magazine. But just look at these pictures. This is just so, so cool. And this magazine, I think it cost me £6 plus shipping. So it wasn't fantastically expensive, and you get to read about these really cool bars. There's really cool pictures, the cool people that work there, that own them, the stereos that they have in there, and just so cool. This one here is kind of dedicated to the Beatles, or they have a lot of Beatles stuff in there. So, and as I mentioned, it's in Japanese and English as well, so everybody can enjoy this. You also get the location of the bar and what sound system they've got. So if you happen to be going to Japan on holiday, on vacation, why not look up one of these bars? I know if I do ever make it over there, I will definitely be trying to hit up as many of these vinyl bars as I can. And this is issue one. I don't know how many they plan to do, if this is an ongoing series, but they have my money. I will definitely be checking every issue of this magazine out, because it's absolutely fantastic. I think in all, maybe it cost me a little bit over £10 and took less than a week to arrive. So if you are curious, if you like the idea of looking at vintage vinyl bars, well, look no further. Well, folks, it's hard to believe, but we have come to the end of another episode of The Record Room. So thank you for joining me. It's very, very much appreciated. We're almost at 100 subscribers on YouTube, which is absolutely fantastic. And if you would like to support the show and you're not already subscribed, why not hit that big red subscribe button on the way out and give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed the show. If you would like to go a little bit further, though, you can always jump over onto our Patreon page. You can find us over there as The Record Room, and you can support the show by donating $1 per month. And for that, you will get an exclusive podcast featuring music talked about on the show, as well as some bonus cuts. And for those of you that are on social media, remember, you can find us there at Record Room Show. But I want to finish this episode with something truly, truly monumental, and that's what this is right here. This is Unsolved Mysteries. I guess you could class this as volume one, or the first in a series, because there is also a second set which I will talk about on a future episode, but this is the first one, and this is something truly, truly exceptional. This is original score cues used in the superb Unsolved Mysteries TV show, released by the legends over at Terrorvision Records. And this is no mere kind of, this isn't your standard release. This is truly, truly exceptional. It really is. This is a 3 LP set. No expense spared. This is just amazing. The music on the albums are Ghosts, Hauntings, and The Unexplained. So anything from the series as a whole that featured Ghosts, Hauntings, or The Unexplained, Ryan Greyface took some of those cues. I believe there are more of them. I did an in-depth conversation with him, podcast with him, probably 2 years ago now. I will link it below so you guys can check it out. We talked about Unsolved Mysteries and the process and everything behind it. It was a really fantastic conversation. As per usual, whenever I'm talking to Ryan, I always have a good time, and he's always, always dropping some great knowledge. But this set is just great. The trifold is just so cool. It's just, this is how I want my trifolds to look. They just look, the covers, just, they're so good. And on the back cover, you get all of the information about the tracks on the album. So much material on this album. I have listened to this entire set more than once, just because Gary Morcan's music is that good. At one point, it was the only album I had on my phone. So whenever I got in my car, it would just play Unsolved Mysteries. And I was like, I'm not going to change it. Who's going to change this? This is great. This is absolutely fantastic. So you get this wonderful, wonderful 3LP set. Really, really beautiful trifold cover. And this is what I love about Terrorvision. You know, it's the small things. It's the presentation of things that really kind of gets me. The albums, the vinyl itself, they're actually supplied in black polylined sleeves. So that's pretty cool. But those aren't the sleeves. You also get printed inner sleeves, which you can choose to use if you so wish. I mean, this is just fantastic. The notes on these inner sleeves. John Cosgrove, the creator of the show, wrote notes for this LP. Ryan Greyface, the man behind Terrorvision, he wrote notes for this LP. And these are double-sided as well. So, so cool. And not only that, but you get these fantastic, fantastic notes here from Gary Morcan, the primary composer of Unsolved Mysteries. And I say primary composer because that's how it's listed here. And there were other people that did contribute to the show over its, 8 seasons? Something like that. It ran for a long, long, long time. But I just love the fact that the trouble that printed in the sleeves, supplied as well. I mean, who else does that? This is so cool with a Terrorvision logo. Absolutely loving this. It's something simple. It's the little things. But for me, it's the little things that go that little bit further. It says, I'm a fan of what I'm doing. It says, I appreciate what people are spending their money on. And I, for one, am for that. So that's what the package looks like. But for the albums themselves, the vinyl themselves, well, this is disc A, which now we can kind of see. It comes on this beautiful blue vinyl. And I will say now, there are a few different variants of this triple LP set. I believe there is also either a single or a double LP version as well. You don't have to go for the full set. And this was sold out for quite a while, but now the exact set that I'm showing off here, which I think it was limited to a very small number, maybe 150, something like that. I believe Ryan has pressed it again. So if you are in the mood for some Unsolved Mysteries, you can jump on over to the Terrorvision Bandcamp page and grab yourself a copy of this. And while you're at it, pick up a copy of the excellent Unsolved Mysteries second set that's come out. I will be talking about that at a future date because, again, it's mind-blowingly cool. So that's LP1. And this is a 3 LP set, so The different colors on these are super, super, super cool. Second LP comes on this really pretty cool crystal clear. I mean, I know on the last episode I said I wasn't a fan of crystal clear, but I don't know, you know, that does look pretty, pretty fine to me. What do you guys think? Are you a fan of the crystal clear vinyl? I think I may actually be coming around. I don't know. And if you're wondering about sound quality on these, well, you know, you could always take my word for it or jump on over to the fantastic Sounds from the Record Room podcast, or just ask around online. These things sound and look fantastic. The third disc there on this really nice green color. Let's just turn that around so you can see the label there. Unsolved Mysteries, released through the excellent Terrorvision Records. I can't say enough about those guys. They're good friends of mine and I love everything they do. They just put out Video Violence, another great score, definitely worth picking up. But there we go, folks. That's it for this episode. Remember, if you're going out and about, if you're hunting, if you're digging, be kind, be courteous, wear gloves, wash your hands, wear a mask, stay gold, and always remember to spin those blackest circles.